Hey, this is Simon Hawk. I'm here going to present you guys with some brand optimization. This is just a little discussion about improving graphics and a presentation on best practices. Some of this is a little basic, so I'm going to kind of breeze through it because I know a lot of you guys are a little more advanced, but even for your personal brands, everybody works a lot on their company or their big projects, but we all have personal branding, so a lot of this can apply to your personal branding if you've already done it for your company. So my background is in design and apparel. I specialize in tropical branding and do a lot of artistic direction. Over the past decade, I've worked with hundreds of different companies, everything from CBD to real estate advertisements, even permaculture mapping design. So really broad spectrum of different design elements. I was born in Pennsylvania, which is where I met Brian. My grandfather was from Greece, so I have kind of like a European background, and now I live in the Caribbean. So I'm here in Puerto Rico at the moment in my design studio. This is where I work. I've been working remotely, just managing projects and advising people on international advertising campaigns for the past 5 years from Puerto Rico. So kind of living down here and just working away online. Nothing really has changed for me recently. I'm pretty used to working remotely. So after the past 15 years of working as like a freelance designer, just a lot of small projects, different startups, everything from jewelry to footwear to e-commerce and tech and solar. A lot of times I was seeing really, really common patterns of branding mistakes. Misconceptions about what branding is, why it should be critical, especially when you're starting a business. A lot of people want to put out a product and they really don't develop their brand. They don't really understand what the brand is. You know, it's not just a logo. It's an entire philosophy and marketing plan for getting the voice of your business out. So having this design strategy actually helps you increase profits in the long run and usually helps start getting brand recognition a lot faster. So it might appear for some people to be like an optional expense or something to focus on later in the business, but it's really how you're evaluated. So whatever you put out there as a company or a person, it's gonna be how people evaluate you as a business and your service. So if that evaluation is low, the amount that they're going to be willing to pay is also gonna be low. So I just finished writing a book, helps people improve branding remotely. The goal is to provide people with strategies to help them improve branding, everything from UX to advertisement design. Also, Simon, decided to go towards the whole, what's that, Brian?
Hey, could you go back to that evaluating your brand for a second?
Yeah, sure.
It was like, I think there was like a lot of in there. When you talk about your evaluation is low, the amount they're willing to pay will be low. Can you speak a little bit more on that? Like I kind of get it from a high level, but it seems like that's like a huge piece of information there.
It is. And I definitely go into it a little bit later in this slide, but I'll definitely quickly breeze over it. If you've ever seen a product that is poorly packaged, your immediate assumption of it is that it's going to be cheap. It's a cheaper product because it looks cheap. And usually that's correct. You know, they don't have a budget to put into it, so it is what it is. But when you look at a really valuable product, not really sure how much it costs to make the actual product because the branding is so strong, the packaging is so highly done. Aesthetically, it really creates something that allows people to think that it's high value, no matter what it costs to make it. So that perceived value is a lot of times is branding. Like people brought out this giant brand from a smaller idea, and that's what increased the value, not necessarily that they started making the product out of gold or plating it in platinum, but that they, you know, put a little bit of gold on the packaging or the cover images on their business where the value was raised up by the quality simply too. Like low resolution graphics scream low quality, so high resolution, high detail HD, you're like, wow, this is nice content. This guy is good. So even as far as like a personal branding standpoint, your cover photo, your banner in Facebook and your photo is a representation of your quality as a person. It's the first thing people are going to judge you on and say, well, it doesn't even have a nice camera. It can't be successful. or this cover photo is very, very spammy. It must be very, like, can't be a good business, you know, whereas a really well-designed logo and layout that clearly defines the message in a valuable way is branding, and that tells the person immediately that the person they're talking to or the brand that they're involved with is of high quality.
So there's lots of aspects in there. You talked about the evaluation and perceived value. And so not only are you talking about the perceived value of packaging, but also the personal packaging of how somebody presents themselves and packages themselves from, like, is that from like a 100%. Career angle or how their own personal evaluation? How does that affect, and maybe we'll talk about this later, but how do you apply that to, like, maybe like marketing campaigns? Or are you saying that the entire experience is branding as well?
I would go as far to say the entire experience is branding. Anything that you put out to the public that people are seeing is something that you chose to design and therefore is a message from your business. So pretty much every single aspect, every email, you know, well-formatted email with good images looks a lot better than a plain text. It looks more professional if it has a header, it has unsubscribe. You know, I've received recently emails from people and it doesn't look professional at all, and I kind of disregard it, you know, like not as successful of a message. So definitely as far as marketing campaigns, especially in advertising, the image that you put out should be branded, you know, even as far as color. To go back to really, really great branding is associated with color psychology. And we'll totally go into that. So let me just skip down through, and because I got a formula for you too, if you like math, for the perceived value. And I repeat all this stuff to a lot of different people because I know a lot of people go really deep into their own niches and their technology, but often forget to apply principles to their own profiles or portfolios or LinkedIn. You know, you'll look at their app and it's incredible, and then their LinkedIn is trash. So it's like that's an inconsistency in branding. You know, like so I wanted to teach that, and I decided to go to the online course method just because I saw a giant shift of people going towards e-learning. Like that's just a trend that I foresee being constantly going up,
especially right now too. This is perfect for my God. This is perfect for this environment right now.
Yeah, and I think this signifies a shift for people to do what they were doing before on a small scale, but make it like a permanent thing. Because if you can learn from home, if you can work from home, I think a lot of people would prefer it. So this was just an option for me to communicate my brand to other people. Because I'm doing this in person a lot. So for me to go from talking to one person to many people, I needed to make a platform like an online course. So that was just the next shift for my business, to go from talking to one person to talking to 100 people at once. So a couple concepts we'll review real quick, just a brief design theory overview, the value of great branding, the breakdown of a beautiful brand, brand design strategies, rebranding resources, and branding project management. So I go a little deeper. I've been doing design for a while, so I usually have to go a little deeper with my clients. They're more complex people, they have more complex requests. So even though sometimes we end up with a very simple design, it comes from a lot of thought and interpretation. So core design principles for branding, great branding is easy to understand at all sizes. A lot of people want to make really complex graphics, but when you shrink them down or put them on an iPhone Instagram profile picture, it's like 100 pixels wide. So it doesn't resonate. So this is a common mistake of really intricate designs or things with thin lines. Color psychology is used always to select a palette with great branding. Color psychology is just how your mind identifies or associates with a different color. Purple is regal and been known to evoke certain emotions, while red is like a hungry color and passion. So you'll see it a lot in restaurants. A design will be timeless if it also works in black and white. So really, really good designs have high contrast. You could flip them to black and white and they still look good. font is often focused on custom design, and more than anything, it needs to be legible and memorable. So some people want to use scripty fonts or cursive, and you can't really read what it is, and it's not as successful resonating in people's minds as something they can read immediately. The logo design should be balanced or even symmetrical. You look at some of the best, and they're literally a mirror version of the left and right side. So it's very easily balanced in the eye. And then KISS, which is keep it stupid simple. Don't overcomplicate design. There's a point at which design becomes really cluttered, and you start distracting from the message. So following core principles doesn't guarantee you inspired design. It's not going to make something that's going to be in a museum possibly, but for the standard of imagery, you can have all of your work have a very clean, and you'll see here all these images are almost all symmetrical. So flip-flop back and forth, pretty much the same. They look good in black and white. And these logos, you can see them in the design 70 years ago, some of them, still holding up today. You know, they might change a colorway or add a little bit of a trending shift in graphic, but these are still the same logos.
I have a question.
Yeah, sorry. Go for it.
For logos, do you recommend a design or a, like IBM is just like words, ABC or words, which one is better? And like, because you have to think about like fonts, or you just have to design a pretty logo?
Sure. And the way I break it down for some people that want to get creative is there's like a logo, like a stamp that is like a corporate logo that we use on smaller things and for general purposes. And then you can have an advanced logo that's more complicated, but it should be an evolution of the smaller one. So the smaller logo, like these stamps, if you go and then look at Apple packaging, they have a really big Apple and it has this whole space theme behind it. That's really creative, but it's like based on this very simple logo that will always stick in people's minds. So if you're trying to design a 50-year brand that lasts for 50 years, and you want it to resonate in people's mind, the simpler the image, the stronger the connection. And then you can extrapolate from that and make more complex graphics from that base. Is usually my recommendation, because I know a lot of people want to go further with it. And this is just too basic, but this is the core principle that then you build from.
Yeah, going off of that, the UConn logo originally was really complicated, and now it's become like super simplistic and really nice. So I can totally see that being beneficial.
Cool. Yeah. You'll see it in a lot of brands too. Like they'll maybe even take advice from a marketing trend and then they'll pull back. Like a lot of companies did that in 80s, like 90s. They went weird and then they're like, okay, no, back to timeless. So that's why I start with this, because like a good black and white movie lasts 100 years longer than, some trashy kids movie. So there's a very, very big difference in styling, and for logo, it's just simpler is better for this mark. And and this is like would be like a watermark and like on letterhead. So that's when you have like very little space. So that's when you use this, and then that more complex graphic for packaging or emails or something you have more room for. And as you can see here, like these are examples of brands that didn't really apply that. They don't really look good in black and white, and then they were changed 7 years later. So the problem with complex graphics and creative marks that are too detailed is that a shift in style or trend will happen, and this is no longer relevant. Whereas those core basic symbols, they never change. Another thing that's really easy to apply to branding, especially logo, is proper spacing. This one also really helps for advertising. I feel like people cram a lot of text into advertisement. So when you look at this document, this page, everything's properly spaced. It's numbered in order. It looks really nice to the eye. It's really easy to read. There's a small amount of information. And all of this is because of proper spacing. When you take a look at this slide, it's really distracting. It's actually kind of hard on the eyes. You're disrupted when you're trying to read because everything is improperly spaced. So in comparison, this it's just very unsettling. The text is paragraphed in the wrong way, the spacing's wrong, there's multiple different text bold colors. One of them makes it actually hard to read, and then it's too close to the bottom. So these are just common mistakes you see a lot of times that make it like unsettling, and you can tell that somebody didn't invest as much time in the brand, therefore usually devaluing your perception of them. So this applies for advertisements as well, proper spacing for graphics. Easiest way to apply proper spacing and create visually interesting content is applying a grid to your work. The grid ensures that there's centering, there's proper spacing, and gives you guide to align things. Also usually allows for more negative space. And if you'll notice the ad on the blue uses a lot of negative space, and it really directs the eye literally up towards the text. Very simple, very successful. A little bit more advanced concept is golden ratio. This is a theory or an idea that's been basically proven in nature through mathematics. And it correlates to the way things that grow. Everything in nature seems to have this spiral to them, and you can actually apply this whole golden rule theory to design to allow for proper spacing. And it naturally orients it because it's a universally accepted layout, basically. It just naturally occurs in seashells and plants and storms. So here's an example of it being used. So the large part on the bottom is where the negative space of the graphic is, and then they're keeping all of the text to the top portion. And it's a 2-3 ratio, basically. So it's just giving a larger portion to the graphic and a smaller portion to the text. You can apply it even to business cards over here, keeping the text to the side and the graphic to the large to the right. So for brand value, great branding creates customer loyalty often, which connects people with high quality branding that they can trust. A lot of times when people are buying repeatedly from people, it's because they trust the brand, they like it. And this is often because of branding. The message that you put out is consistent and a trustworthy message. The concept applies in reverse as well. Bad packaging usually equals a bad product. You're not going to expect something inside of an ugly box to be pretty. So it works in the reverse as well. It can hurt you. So it's hard to, like a good example is it's hard to trust what's inside of a brown paper bag. But if you see somebody walking down the street with Victoria's Secret's bag, you know exactly what's in it, and that it's high quality lingerie, and that it has a certain association with it. Whereas a brown paper bag, you have no idea what's inside it, and it could be trash. As far as upsell, the power to upsell a product is influenced highly by how much the customer values the brand. Think about how repeatedly you buy from the same brand. Apple is a great example, and I just repeatedly buy stuff from Apple. Like I do it over and over again. Like it's branded in my mind that I love this product and what they make, and that's something that they've manufactured highly. Brian, this is the slide for you. This is the perceived value formula. So at the beginning of this presentation, and I made this up. I didn't copy this from somewhere. Like literally somebody threw a question at me and I came back to them with this. So this is PV equals BP plus MQ times VA plus PC. The product value equals brand perception plus marketing quality times the value added and the product cost. So the price the consumer is going to be willing to pay for the product is dependent on the status and appearance of the company, plus the value of the product provided to the customer and the cost to make the product. So a breakdown of that would be like if you wanted to sell a product for $1,000, like, and right now it's a book, by doubling your efforts in brand perception and increasing marketing quality, this would multiply the cost of the product and the value it adds. So if you sell a digital product that only costs you $150 to make and it realistically provides $100 of value to a customer, you could greatly increase the sale price of the product by increasing the branding and image that represents the product. So right down here, it says $100 product plus $150 of value. If you double the marketing, double the quality, this would equal a higher premium value of 4 times 250, which is your $1,000 product.
Which is a perceived value, right?
Perceived value, yes, exactly. So if you had nothing else, that you could no longer advance this product anymore, you couldn't do anything else, but you wanted to charge more, you could make the branding look so good and you could put twice as much into advertising and you could equal up to that $1,000 by simply by positioning yourself in a different place. Like say you had a car product and instead of marketing towards lower end cars, you started marketing and towards higher end cars, owners, and those people have more money to spend. And if you increase your branding and they associate with it, you have a product that's aligned with them. Therefore you could sell it for $1,000, even though it's no different of a product. You just marketed it.
Super interesting.
So the why branding matters is it increases sales, it increases value and profit margins, and it develops a set for success. So let's look at the difference between two products. One company invests in high quality design to elevate their branding, and the other does not. So the breakdown of a beautiful brand, like we all know the Ritz-Carlton, it's a pristine brand, it's well known for high quality. You know, if you go into their door, you're going to spend a lot of money. Like before you even walk in, if this logo is on the front of the building, you know that you're about to pay a lot of money. And so they have a high quality branding and they have a high investment in design. Therefore, they have a high value product. In comparison, we've probably all seen the Super Motel 8 alongside of the road. You know exactly what you're getting at Motel 8. You're getting a bed and maybe a TV, and it's going to be under $100. And so they have low quality branding and they have a low investment in design. Therefore, they have a low value product. And they would never try to sell more because they can't charge any more for their product because they're not marketing it or increasing the design of it. They're keeping at their standard. So another one that I actually was recently introduced with, I researched this. I was going to use Starbucks. And then if you know anything about Starbucks branding, is actually, it was a disaster. They had a lot of problems, some really bad feedback from the design to the, it was a headache. So as I was looking for a good brand, I stumbled on this Blue Bottle Coffee company, which another friend of mine had recently referenced. I'd never heard of them, but immediately you look at everything they have and it's a beautiful design.
Oh, Simon, I know you've been a little bit out of the San Francisco scene for a little bit.
I was like, well, what Blue Bottle?
Yeah, but you are either a Phil's Coffee connoisseur or you are a Blue Bottle connoisseur, and it's the Phil's Coffee versus Blue Bottle wars out there. Like Starbucks is like is passé, and everything is. Oh, are you Blue Bottle or are you Phil's?
Yeah,
it's great. I'm a Blue Bottle person.
From my research, I would be Blue Bottle 100%. Like they're on point. Like they really are. And they've won Brian over already with their great branding. So they have an extremely high awareness and they're there. They have roots in tech industry. And so they're very smart. They chose a minimalistic design. I mean, look at this logo. It's hardly a shape, but it's very iconic. It's very simple. The text is extremely legible.
They also give away tchotchkes like you all the time. They're just sitting there. There's like pins sitting there. There's cards. There's like little
all blue and branded.
Yeah,
branded out.
Yeah, on everything that they do, like their candy little mints candy box has the little logo, and then they're giving them away for free like all the time too. So you're always kind of taking
one to punch in like that brand as much as they can. They're really strong for that. I have a lot of respect for them as I was looking at them.
Their internal like experience, like in the store, it fits their design so beautifully as well. It's super minimal. It's Like you get presented with your order right away, and then like just everything about it is clean and clear and minimal, and there's not a lot of stuff in their way, and they always tend to have high ceilings. I love
it. You're justifying my thoughts completely.
They tend to have high ceilings, so it feels like there's space, even if there isn't. Like, because their lines
super
are really
high
long.
Attention to design and detail, right? Like to like an excessive point, like Apple standard for sure.
Yeah, and
like,
then
direct cues.
They also make the line, if there's a line out, generally outside of the place. So the queue, so you're not stuffing people into the place for the line. Like,
right,
so they try
yeah,
to.
Starbucks is that like huddle where you're like, I don't know where.
Yeah, they've thought through like everything like really, really well.
Yeah, and I'm glad because I've never been to this place. So Brian is like an actual customer. This for me was theoretical. I was like looking at this online as like, and so this is what I came up with. Yeah, it's directly taken from Apple. It's like custom blue, white everywhere. So you've been in one and you know that in fact, it really does resonate. It really works well.
That makes sense.
Whenever somebody interacts with the blue bottle, like it's a consistent experience. And that's why they're hitting you with all this packaging.
It's very, very similar to an Apple store. That's weird. Now that you say that, it's like, that makes total sense.
Yeah. If you look at it from that aesthetic, like, and that's, it's a really good philosophy. I mean, if you're going to follow somebody and start a coffee brand in San Francisco, like follow the best, like don't be following, Hewlett Packard or whatever. So this experience extends, as Brian's noticing, far past packaging. You know, it can relate into interior design. When a customer snaps a picture in front of the cafe, they're actually boosting the status of the followers, and this all translates into how the brand is perceived. So they're raising their perceived value all the time, and they're doing it using other people, using customers to create content. So on social media, they already have 365,000 followers. And this is, you know, not by accident. This is like a strategy of theirs. This was really cool. This was a great, great graphic. And Brian, this probably explains a lot. But so Blue Bottle started out 20 years ago. The guy was just a surfer. And they started this company and branded it and raised $225.8 million. All from Silicon Valley people. Look at these people. Google Ventures, WordPress, Twitter, Instagram. Like, this is stacked for a coffee company. Like, they are very, very ambitious and they did everything right. I mean, everything's perfect. So they're funded. I think right now they actually have more funding than revenue. So they're like totally stocked up and in position to be the leader in the coffee business after Starbucks has had like 30 years, right? So, slow are the basic elements that build up to a great brand. So these are like the core elements, the little things that would build up all that. An iconic logo for to identify the brand, a custom font to set it apart, a consistent color palette to recognize it, a website with branded content, packaging worth photographing, product design that's memorable, consistent social media content, and high quality branded photography. So all of those things together are what I consider to be a brand. These are all the elements, everything kind of communicates and translates the message that you pick.
Do you have anything the most important?
Probably the most important thing?
Or like where to start if you can only put limited resources on one of these?
Sure. I think it depends where your customers are coming from. So like if you had the majority of your customers coming through Facebook, I'd say the most important branding aspect would be your cover photo and your Facebook profile. If you had a lot of customers coming through Shopify, then you're looking at packaging and or advertisements. But almost always that comes from, to be honest, a color palette. And then a style guide is not in here, but it's kind of all of these things together. A style guide just says, this is what the logo looks like. This is what the font you use, the color palette. So the most important thing would be a style guide, which probably includes like 1 through 3. and that's the logo, the font, and the color palette. If those things are always consistently the same, and then your style, as far as the content you're putting out and the imagery is all on point, I think people then identify the brand much more concisely. Like, you do this, and this is the level of quality at that. Like, I do very fast, cheap, you know, high quality designs. Like, that's what I try to like communicate to people in my branding, and what other people have to say is dependent on where the channel is and what the message is.
Got it.
So for brand strategy, that's kind of like a combination of both design and theory at the same time. Design can be the images of everything, and then theory is more of the strategy, where you position it, the plans. This Venn diagram kind of helps you understand that a little bit. This is also the basis for the MasterCard logo. It's just two circles. Next, it's an orange and a yellow circle. But so this is actually one of the, like, the biggest companies on the planet. This is their logo, two circles. Proper research, the proper approach to developing a high value brand strategy. If you're starting a new company or if you're rebranding, we don't just randomly make up ideas. We go through research, we strategize, we find a position, and then we implement. So proper research in the market often involves looking at the competition, looking at the trends, preparing like where you want to go, high end, low end, the amount of volume of business you're trying to do often also dictates your brand. If you'll notice too, these four circles also represent the Audi logo, one of the largest car companies in the world. It's four circles, not very difficult. So selecting a brand color palette, like you guys are saying, what's the one of the first things probably you can do is stay within maybe five to six colors. Keep all your content, all your logos, everything within a similar color scheme. Like blue bottle coffee, it's blue and white. You're all gonna see from them blue and white stuff. So this process is actually dictated more by the market first and the customer second than your personal opinion. So a lot of people wanna say, oh, this is what I think is my favorite color. I want this, this is what I'm imagining. But really what you want to do is probably put out a couple of different color schemes and then test your market specifically and see what they want. Because if you're an older gentleman and your products are being sold to a younger female, what you like may be completely off from what the market wants. And you would want to pick something based on their opinion, not yours, if you're trying to sell it to them and not yourself. So if a product is to be sold in health and wellness, genre to primarily women, the palette should reflect their lifestyle. Female buyers often prefer softer, natural palettes. So on the right, you'll see kind of all these different products. They're all light and bright and green. You kind of get the idea that they're healthy and natural products, kind of focused towards women. A breakdown of your brand color. This is what could go into your style guide. You would save all these different colors, and then anytime you wanted to make an advertisement or if you needed to create a banner or anything like that, you would literally sample back from this. So then as you go through and all your different profiles will all look the same. So usually we break it down into a dominant color. So it's like for blue bottle, it's blue and white. And then their accent colors, it looked like they were using natural wood, metal. These would be their other colors. And those are all breaking down into shades, tints, and tones, which are just lighter variations of the same. So if you do need to create a more complex graphic, you can use shades and tones to give it a little more depth instead of just using five colors. If you don't know where to begin for your branding coloring, you can literally sample it from other brands. So a lot of times you can go and take a look at a magazine or an image or something relating to what you do. So say you're in tech industry and you really want this to be like a circuit board company related product. You go and sample the colors off of a circuit board, and you know that your products are gonna relate to that product. So it's a really easy way. You can just pick out an image and then literally sample from it, and there's your palette. So an example of tropical branding, which is a lot of what I do, get customers that want, you know, the beach vibe, they're looking for a healthy product. For that kind of demographic, it's usually 21 to 45, they're younger. Their focus is on lifestyle and health. The goal of the ads and the artwork that we usually do is to communicate the benefits of healthy life and increase the value of the product by creating a vibe or a brand image that that is high quality. So visually displaying a natural color scheme and then showcasing people enjoying the product. So design strategy applied to social media. You can do the exact same thing for your logo, for your company, with your branding and your social media. So you can use the same style guide to find color palettes by pros. You can go and look at other people, like other people's feed. You'll see they're really stylized, they're really colorful. You say, wow, that actually really works for me. This light coloring. So I'm gonna use like a light feed, and I'm gonna choose softer tones. You can go and look on social media for people in the lifestyle and search for kind of looks and get cues from what's actually going on in the market. You can get inspired by industry leaders by looking at culture. You can look for colors, for tips from the bigger brands. The bigger the company, the more money they have to research color psychology and theory and market tests. So a lot of times their colors are better. So you go on there and they have these really rich tones and these really unique things, and you can kind of sample elements from different things. you can stay up to date with social media. It's really helpful to look at what's modern, what's going on. And if you are going to take cues from people design-wise, choose from really good companies. Don't look at companies that don't make any money.
Simon, I have to say that I was not a believer in some of this 3-4 years ago. When I met the founder of PlanThat.com, mm-hmm. Plan, she runs this Instagram kind of rearrangement software, so you can have all the color palette or choose the color palette, and then it'll combine the pictures of where you want to see on the screen, with grid style and individual scrolling. And I was like, cool. This is the silliest thing ever, and I was so wrong. Like, and now
if you look at like makeup companies and stuff like that, they hit that stuff hard. Yeah. E-commerce especially.
Yeah. And so it was like this planning, so they can plan to schedule the pictures, not only the pictures that are going to, and posts that are going to go out, but also in alignment with brand colors and brand strategy. And almost like this, nobody's doing this. And she's like, no, this is the standard social media, like for like you said, for like makeup companies, for anything that's within the that's aligning to like a female demographic, sell mm-hmm. way better on Instagram when you align the colors and the schemes and all that stuff. And she's blown it up now. It's like one of the fastest growing like social media products in existence.
No, and you take a look at the difference between like a really great brand on social media and somebody just getting started, and they've got scattered colors. They have, it's not a cohesive, like you scroll through and it, you know, it's just random content. And you look at a really high level company that's getting great engagement, and it's like a TV channel. They put out mm-hmm. a consistent show, and the people that go to that channel expect to see a certain level of quality. And if you give it to them every single time, you keep getting more followers. I see a lot of people where they switch styles and then they lose their certain demographic.
My caveat to that would be you already have to know exactly the audience that you want, right?
Yes, agreed.
So if you're going through, if you don't have product market fit as of yet, it's okay. Are you saying, would you say that it's okay for your brand to be malleable until you've kind of defined your audience?
Yeah, definitely. Especially, yeah, if you're in a groove that's not working. Yeah, because branding can really be refined. You know, like, yeah, it's unlikely that a startup will establish the best brand possible. Coming out with a solid brand and getting a reaction on it, rather than doing multiple things, it's like easier to evaluate a test with a constant, right?
Yeah.
So yeah, instead of trying 7 different things, try one for 30 days, and if that's not working, switch up an element of it, and then you have a control. But people that try wildly different marketing strategies, you're getting a different variable every time. So it's like it can be difficult unless you've got the budget for that, and you're like. But most of the time, they're always running the same core ads, and then trying a different. You know, they're split testing something else as well.
So, yeah. So this is
a big part of rebranding.
So this isn't more of a question, and I think there's like a conversation here, but like what I think is like kind of like never really thought of before, but if you look at like blue bottle, very, very visual. Blue, it's a color, bottle. I can picture a bottle in my mind. Another iconic one is Apple, and like the Apple logo. And then it's going to go wildly, and I don't want to get political here, but in a lot of the conversations or speeches that our current president basically had, he would use a lot of visual cues, simple language and very visual cues. Let's build a wall, right? Everybody in their mind can picture a wall, and the language is very simple. So then
red hats was a very specific design decision. You know, the color red, the power, the wording, the text, it was all very well designed in my opinion. You know, not my style at all, not my preference, not my choice.
Sure.
But effective, yes. And what were his advertising campaigns converting? Yeah, they definitely were. So, but, you know.
Yeah, and I think the key here of what's kicking in my head, because we're kind of going through like a rebrand right now, is that these are all tangible objects, right? The hat, the wall, the apple, the bottle.
Promotional products.
Yeah, they're tangible. That like you can hold these items in your hand. You can see the silhouette. Like and so maybe I'm like hypothesizing. It's not the best thing to have complex ideas as a strong brand. Like
simpler is better, because you can't embroider complex things on hats. Like you can't stamp, you know, these big graphics onto, you know, boxes. Like the things that really work, you know, they're like easily relatable at all sizes and scales. And yeah, it's like those simpler objects just resonate in the brand, in the mind. And there's a lot of psychology that goes into that too. Like, you know, the mind can only remember so many aspects of a thing. So the more complex it is, the harder it is to relate to. Whereas if it's like just an apple, like it sticks in your head, like I know exactly what that is. And that's why people use other things. They don't always try to make a new piece of art. Like Hilton or the Ritz-Carlton is a lion. We all know what a lion is. Apple is an apple. Like they're not creating something that then your brain has to attach to. They're like familiarizing it with something that your brain is associating with power and strength. Or, I mean, I don't know why they chose apple, but it worked. They're delicious. So if you're not a designer and you're not artistic at all, and if you're on a budget, these are my recommendations. So if you're not into design and you're not trying to learn these things, if you're on a budget, you do have to do it yourself, but you can use templates, guides, online programs, and apps that are free. If you have a small budget, you can hire entry-level remote workers. I'm pretty sure everybody on here has been on Fiverr and Upwork. Great resource. You just tell them what you want and get 3 to 4 people to bid on it. If you have a medium budget, you can hire an experienced designer. I really suggest like starting relationships with people that whose work that you like. You find a good designer and then you just pay them per project. It's like having an employee, but you just hit them up every so often. If you have a large budget, then you should always hire an agency that has access to a group of designers. You do not want to manage multiple creatives if that's not what your business plan entails. You want to hire an agency that has access to multiple designers, so then they can manage them, come back to you with results, and then you can give them decisions and they can do all the communication. Because managing and communicating with creatives is totally different than working with people on the back end. So usually I don't suggest that software developing people try to tell graphic people what to do, unless they have a really clear idea of what they want to do. The best tool to use lately that just recently came out is Canva. You can make designs as a complete novice. All of these designs are made in a couple minutes very easily, and it's a free app. Setting up photography standards. So it's really important to establish a standard of quality, at the very least, for your style and your content of imagery. Whether you purchase the photography from a stock company or you shoot it yourself, you should just pick high quality images. You can choose high resolution images, high definition, but whatever it is, just make sure it's really clear quality and really high standard. That way your perceived value will always be high. So even when you buy from other people, or you can just buy the best. So these are some upcoming trends for 2020 that I was looking into. There's a big emphasis on 3D. So in 2019, 3D software got a lot easier, got a lot quicker, more automation. So there's applications like Lumion, SketchUp, Blender. These are all tools that if you go on Fiverr and you need 3D work, just start finding it a lot cheaper because people aren't doing things in Rhino and all that anymore. So gradients, you're starting to see, especially in tech, like you guys see a lot of these cool washes of color. Apple used to do it a lot. This is gaining popularity, and it makes things not so boring and monotonous when there's rich shades. Minimalism, this is one of my favorites. Minimalist designs consider the use of colors that are not excessive and provide sufficient white space in the design. Duotones is another really cool one. You see this a lot. This replaces the role of black and white in a graphic. So anything that's white, they do it all one color, and then everything else is black. So it gets this kind of cool background effect. You can put white letters on it and still have a really complex graphic in the background, but you've removed all the colors, so it's not distracting to the eye. It almost becomes a texture in the background. It's really futuristic, makes designs look more interesting, especially for web design. If you're gonna do a background, you can do duotone and then put text over top. Oversized hand lettering. So typography, a lot of people just pick their font from the list of fonts available. The better the brand, the more custom their font would be. So you can pay on Fiverr to have somebody design a font for you. Really not that difficult. And then you have a custom font that's very specific to your company. Using that would be ideal. Here's a good example of those. Brian, can you hear me?
Yes. We're just kind of like talking in the background. We're kind of getting, we're running out of time here. Got like about 10 more minutes left. There's a couple questions.
Yeah, why don't we stop with this slide?
Okay, cool. There's a couple questions we love to ask every one of our guests. And so I always like to ask this question. It's like, you can flip it on its head either way, side of the question. It's, what was your favorite campaign that you worked on that you thought would work that didn't work, or that you were surprised that worked?
Sure. So rather than both, I'd rather talk about, I think my headphone just died. You hear me?
Yeah, you're good.
Sweet, I got the left one in. So rather than talk about something that went well, I'd do rather talk about something that happened bad. So I do have a client that that we ran some ads for, and they kept getting denied. And this was mostly because of the sector. And basically what had to happen was I had to hire somebody to do the copy. I'm more on the side of design. And so what was really stopping my ads from getting approved was the writing. Content. So I always focus on design. So I had put a lot of work into creating great graphics, and then, you know, I just repeatedly tried to enter this ad campaign, and it would not get approved due to the content. So I had to hire somebody to rewrite it, and then finally got approved. And it's converted well now, but it was really frustrating for a while. And that was kind of led me onto a foray of like learning a lot more about Facebook restrictions on advertising. This was in the CBD space, so it's a rather complex subject. And I had to hire a professional, like somebody that knew that very, very specifically well.
Had to step through the landmines appropriately in the regulation.
Yeah. I just had to submit, you know, there's some problems you can't solve on your own, and that certain people have trained specifically for, and they just have the knowledge a lot faster, and it's better to pay them, you know, well for their time.
Mm-hmm. Ross, what was the what's our other three question? 1, 2, 3 punch.
Second question is always, what is the resource that you like to go to the most to stay up to date or learn new things to make yourself ahead of the wave?
Yeah, Google Trends.
So is that Google Trends, does that teach you about the newest in branding and marketing, or what specifically are you trying to learn?
Sure. I use it for product, identifying products for customers. A lot of people come to me and start an e-commerce site, and then they don't, you know, they know kind of what genres they want to sell in, but they're not exactly sure of the product. And then for Google queries, it does help me stay on top of design things. So I can type in queries and see how many people are searching for a different subject, whether or not it's relevant. If it's just me, like a lot of times I self-check my perception of reality. So I always go and look. I'm like, oh, do other people think this too? And like, yeah, like they type it into Google. So like how to do this is a really great indicator of like how many other people are interested in doing something that you're trying to teach or provide. So if you're solving a product and there's 100,000 plus queries a month on that, you know, you know that you have 100,000 possible customers.
Do you have a good example of when someone wanted to solve one problem, but Google Trends kind of, you said you should shift your thing slightly to solve this other problem because there's actually people who want that solution, not this one?
Yeah, no, that definitely happens with my clients in Denver. You know, they have a lot of perceptions about what the market wants. And multiple times we've had to do market research to validate that, in fact, nobody wanted that. So yeah. And then you show them a case study of another brand that, you know, is in the same sector and clearly made a different direction shift, and that they've shown profit and had good success. It's much better, you know, than trying something new. It's never been done. It might be a failure.
For sure. That's the best and the worst. When you don't make something new, but you don't have to waste 6 months making something that's going to fail. And you make something.
Yeah. And in tech, it's a little harder. You guys are always trying to make something new. So,
for sure. Learn fast, fail fast. The question we usually follow up with is, so it's kind of along the same line, but who do you like to learn from? Like a specific person that if you could interview them for an hour to learn more, like not who's your idol, but who do you think is the smartest person that is teaching the most relevant material these days?
Oh, that's really interesting. I was listening to Gary Vee this morning. I like some of his stuff. He's definitely not technical. I think he errs on the side of motivational, if anything. So I'm not sure how much you can learn from him, but I think it's important to recognize his mentality and that attitude or willingness to do whatever he does. And he does some odd stuff, but he really, you know, he puts that brand on it. It's all branded, you know, it's all part of the Gary Vee brand. So as far as branding, this dude's pretty on point, for sure. After that, I'm a little old school. I love Richard Branson. He's like an old guy, but he started Virgin Records. He started Virgin Airplane. Insane branding person. You know, literally Virgin everything. I guess, you know, he just slapped that on it all. And each time it was like a status symbol of success and high quality. Like Virgin, you know, Virgin flights are $800 to get like $200 worth of distance, you know, but they love it and people pay it because it's a branded experience. Literally, I think the only thing different is the interior and their customer service. I mean, it's an airplane, so how much different can it be? I think it's the same airplane, but they literally wrap it in red. And then when you walk in, it's all white. And I think it has like blue and pink lights, and the ice cubes have Richard Branson's face on them.
I'm sorry, what, huh? Really?
Yeah. Really? Yeah, I heard that. I have not confirmed this, but the ice cubes on Virgin flights have Richard Branson's face on them.
I don't know if I'd pay more for that. That's a little creepy.
I don't know if I would either. But
overall, I completely agree with you.
Yeah.
Like,
I'm going to eat your face.
Yeah, I go by the Virgin Hotel in San Francisco, and I'm like, I didn't even know they had hotels, but it must be fancy.
Yeah, it must be fancy, right? Like, you know, it's going to be that. So yeah, those are two great branding guys. Gary Vee's young, Branson's old. So if you want to look at comparative people, those are some two good people that I'd like to follow. I wouldn't mind sitting down with them and shooting the shit and see what they thought about my ideas. I think they would both have great perspective, very polar opposite perspective. I would, you know, I think Gary Vee shoots from the hip and just, he says what he thinks at the moment. And a guy like Branson would, you know, look back on 45 years of experience and tell you some pretty accurate advice.
Yeah. Nice. So this has been a great presentation. I love branding. We should get Carlos on here. He probably loves it too. My first experience with branding was making a product in college and realizing that I could get people to pay twice as much for it if I bought the same box that Apple puts their iPhones in. They buy a $5 to $10 box to put their phone in that you throw away. And I thought that was crazy, but they put a $900 to $1,000 phone in it. So it's totally worth it. And so ever since then, I've always been on the vein of, you know, loving branding if and when you have the money to pay for it, to make it worth the amount of value you're going to get out of it. So
sure,
thank you
like
so
people
much.
People looking to scale companies, you know, whenever you're looking to sell more, sell higher volume of it, then it's a good time for high level focus on branding, because then it, you know, you're tweaking something, and often branding is one of the cheaper things that you can tweak. You can't cheaply tweak manufacturing or distribution. Those are like more difficult processes. But with branding, you're pushing out a new graphic. It's pretty simple.
For sure. With tech or travel and experiences, something that starts with a high ticket item totally makes sense. I was selling a $20 object in college, and paying $10 for branding didn't really make sense to double it.
No, right. It wasn't proportional.
Exactly. I've always loved all this though. So thank you for a great presentation. The wrap-up question that we always ask is, when people want to learn more from you, where's the best place that they can reach out? And do you have any resources online that they can dive deeper into?
Sure. Yeah, I have my personal website, which serves as a portfolio and offers some services. So you can see some of the work that I've done at simonhawk.com, so www.simonhawk.com. And then my company, which we focus on agriculture, larger corporations, bigger business, that's sagedesignconsult.com. Yeah, so you can check those out, see the work that we do, the rates that we offer. Always interested in talking to people and giving advice. So always do a consultation for free. And if you like what we say and what we do, happy to help you out more.
This has been awesome. Simon, long time friend, and glad to get you on the show. This has been Masters of Marketing, and we'd love to have you come back again in a couple months as we grow our audience and get you in front of a whole bunch of people. It's been rad. Thank you.
I would be happy to come back. Thanks so much for having me, guys.
Awesome. Thanks, Simon.
All right, signing off.
Take care, guys.